Hi guys, so we are meeting after a long time. So there is an announcement. From today we'll start our BSR courses, and that is offered in our UG and post graduation education, and we'll cover all the subjects. Okay, first we'll go for principle of surgery, that is the basics of surgery. Next we'll go for anesthesiology, then diagnostic, like that. We'll cover soft tissue surgery, then the ophthalmology and dentistry. We'll cover all the courses. So in this lecture video I will point out different objectives or short notes or long type questions which can come in your examination. So let us start from our first subject, that is principles of surgery, and this is basically the introduction part. From next lecture video we'll start the main principles of surgery. So first of all, the basics, surgery, which comes from a word chirurgia, spelled as chirurgia, which is combination of two words. You can pronounce as you like, okay, chair or care, anything. Just remember the spelling. Okay, C-H-E-I-R, which means hand, ergon means work. Okay, that means surgery deals with procedures, manual procedures, or work by hand for treatment of animals. This is basics of surgery. Remember, don't, for me, I won't advise you to remember the book definitions. Okay, understand what is the suppose this is exploratory surgery, understand what is exploratory surgery and write in your own terms. Okay, don't go for exact bookish terms. Okay, that if you are going for only like Rattabaj, then that is won't help you. Okay, understand what is this and you will remember it. You can write in your own words. Now these are either you can name it as types of surgery or branches of surgery. I have used color coded for remembering. Okay, first one is antiseptic surgery and aseptic surgery. This concept will be cleared in my next video when I will, or subsequent video when I will talk about principles of asepsis. Okay, there I will mention antiseptic and aseptic surgery in a clear way. For now, antiseptic surgery means surgery conducted by using antiseptic agents. Aseptic, you see any word with A is absence. Okay, absence. So absence of any septic. Septic means usually bacterial contamination. Okay, but it can be multi-organ contamination, multi-organism contamination, but mostly it refers to bacterial contamination. Okay, aseptic means absence of, you conduct surgery in the absence of bacterial contamination. Next, constructive and radical. Constructive surgery means wherein you perform surgery to restore or preserve a organ. Suppose a case comes of fracture. Okay, suppose there is a fracture of metatarsal, metacarpal, any bone. Okay, so there you preserve the metacarpal bone or the metatarsal bone. You try to preserve, that is known as conservative surgery. Now radical surgery. In radical surgery, you remove the root cause. Okay, sometimes even you have to remove some organs also. Suppose there is a case of mammary tumor. Best example is mammary tumor. See, in mammary tumor, there is a tumor of mammary gland. Okay, there you cannot perform the conservative surgery. You have to remove the whole mammary gland. So this is radical surgery. Also, hernia can be an example of radical surgery, where you have to perform hernioraphy. Next, minor or major, this is classified according to life risk. If there is no life risk, this is minor surgery, and if there is life risk, that is major surgery. You see, all the operations performed on general anesthesia are major surgeries, because general anesthesia itself poses threat to the life. Okay, there can mishappening can be there, so all the major operations come under life risk, have life risk. Examples are C-section, OHE, okay, plating, anything. Minor surgery are abscess, if you are caught opening an abscess, okay, cyst, wound dressing, these are minor surgeries. For minor surgery, you may or may not need anesthetics. Sometimes they can be performed on local anesthetics or mild sedation. Okay, there is a difference between sedation and anesthesia. I have discussed in anesthesia lecture video, you can refer to that. Okay, so next, emergency surgery and elective surgery. Remember, emergency means you cannot postpone the surgery, you have to do surgery. Suppose there is a compound fracture, okay, a case come as compound fracture, you have to perform surgery. Whether you are using any external coaptation bandage or internal immobilization, you have to perform the surgery. You have to attend the patient, you have to do surgery. Whether it's in elective, you can postpone. Suppose there is a family planning operation, that is the best example for elective surgery, family planning operation. You can postpone as you like, okay? So based on whether you can postpone the surgery or not, emergency and elective. Next, cosmetic, reconstructive and plastic surgery. You see, in cosmetic surgery, you perform surgery to satisfy the sentiment or fancy of the owner. The best examples are ear cropping, docking, okay. Many of the owner of Doberman or Rottweiler, they will come for docking because they want to, their sentiment is if it is a Rottweiler or Doberman, you have to cut the tail. But as a surgeon, you should know ear cropping and docking, they are banned. You cannot perform ear cropping or docking if it is not meant for radical surgery. If there is some pathology, you can do these operations. Otherwise, in normal conditions, you cannot do these operations. If any patient owner is coming to you, please avoid these two surgeries, ear cropping and docking. These are banned, okay? Next, reconstructive surgery. You see, re means again. Okay. So, you are constructing something again. That means, on the first go, there is some deformities or malformations. So, surgery performed to correct the malformation or deformity is known as reconstructive. You are constructing it again. So, reconstructing. Best examples are atresia ani surgery. There is no anal opening. So, you are performing reconstructive surgery to give an opening. Also, cleft palate. Okay. These are surgeries which come under reconstructive surgery. Next is plastic surgery. In case of plastic surgery, you transfer a tissue from one part and you correct the deformity on another part. See, plastic surgery can be cosmetic or can be reconstructive, depending on whether you are correcting some malformation or deformity by transfer of tissues, then it can be reconstructive plastic surgery. Or if you are doing some cosmetic surgery for change some appearance of the animals like that, then it is cosmetic plastic surgery, okay? So, next, exploratory surgery and experimental surgery. See, exploratory surgery means you perform surgery for diagnostic purpose. See, in field condition, you don't have any x-ray or ultrasonography examination or anything. So, suppose a case of a ruminant comes to you and there is history of recurrent tympani. So, in recurrent tympani, first and foremost suspect for the amphistomesis. In amphistomesis, there will be recurrent tympani. But in field cases, you will get the case after giving oxyclozanide or anything, treatment for amphistomesis will be there. So, you will go for, there may be many cases. Okay, maybe abomasal, omasal blockage or maybe any foreign body in rumen or reticulum, anything. So, you don't know, do not have any diagnostic procedure. You have to go for ruminotomy to know whether what is the cause of the disease. Then those cases are exploratory surgery. So, example are exploratory ruminotomy or exploratory laparotomy. Okay. When you use surgery for a diagnosis. Okay, next, experimental surgery. When you are doing some new technique or systemic investigation of a part, that is known as experimental surgery, new research. Next, clinical surgery. Clinical surgery means surgery is taught by teachers to students. That is known as clinical surgery. When surgery is performed in the presence of students, where students can take history, know the anesthetic protocols, know the surgery protocols, those are known as clinical surgery. So now we'll go for tenets of Halstead. This can come as a short note or long type question in your internal examination or external examination. So first one is gentle handling of tissues. That means you should avoid unnecessary clamping, okay, or unnecessary pulling of tissues. Okay, hard tissue and soft tissue are handled differently, so you should know. Let us take an example of a tumor surgery. By that example we will understand all the tenets. Okay, let us take an example of a tumor. Suppose there is a mammary tumor. Okay, this is a mammary tumor. So this is a soft tissue tumor. Okay, so handling of this tissue is different. You have to very delicate. Do not unnecessarily pull or push or clamp these tumors. Okay, be gentle. Next is aseptic surgery. That means you have to perform surgery under aseptic condition. Aseptic means absence of bacterial contamination. So first you have to save this area, then you have to scrub this area with antiseptic solutions. This aseptic surgery will be better dealt in principle of asepsis. Okay, in that class I will mention which are the antiseptic or aseptic agents, how can we maintain a sterile field condition. Those will be covered in principles of asepsis. For now, for today's class, this is you have to clip the hairs, you have to prepare the side, you have to scrub the antiseptic solution, then you have to drape it so that surrounding infections cannot come. So this is aseptic surgery. You have to take necessary steps to avoid sepsis or bacterial contamination. Next comes the anatomical dissection. So you have to know the anatomy of this mammary tumor. You see, the mammary tumor, mammary gland is basically modified sweat gland, so it will be in skin. Okay, above this there will be muscle, the abdominal muscles, or if it is a thoracic part, then the thoracic muscles. Okay, the tumor will be between the muscle and the skin. So while dissecting or removing the tumor, do not apply too much pressure on the abdominal muscles. You may rupture the abdominal muscles. Okay, so you have to know this abdominal muscles. Then you have to know blood vessels. There will be mammary vessels, both artery and vein. Okay, mammary vessels, there will be nerve fiber. Most importantly, you should know the vessels. Okay, in tumor, most of the mammary tumor may find 2 to 3 major vessels, big vessels, and many small vessels. Okay, so you have to know the vessels. Okay, these are nothing but knowing the anatomy before going for surgery. You have to know the anatomy. Sometimes I had done my research on mammary tumors actually. So if you will go for an ultrasonography, you can know how many vessels are present, so that you can do surgery better. Okay, so this is anatomy, knowing the anatomy. Another example I can give you: if you are going for enterotomy operation, you are giving to incision to intestine. You see, intestine, this is intestine. Okay, intestine has two borders, the mesenteric border, then the anti-mesenteric border. The mesenteric border contains all the blood vessels. Okay, this is anatomy. So how can I apply the anatomy? While giving incision, always give incision in anti-mesenteric border, where the blood vessels are less, so that the bleeding will be less. So this is anatomy. Also, you should know the anatomy between the intestine and esophagus. In esophagus, the serosa is absent. Okay, the serosa is main layer which keeps the sutures tension. Okay, so in intestine, you should know the opposition is made serosa to serosa. Okay, this is knowing the anatomy. Next, control of hemorrhage. I will discuss the methods last, but for this control of hemorrhage, so while after giving incision, suppose this is a stalked tumor, actually there is a stalk, you see, and mass is hanging. Okay, after giving incision, suppose you are given an incision, circular incision, okay, you will find blood vessels. So you have to control the hemorrhage because there will be bleeding. sometimes the bigger vessels will be visible. Do not cut this vessel, first ligate them, then cut the vessel. That is known as control of hemorrhage. Major intraoperative death are due to blood loss, okay? So avoid bloods. But you should know, if you are doing surgery, there will be bleeding. Okay. It doesn't mean that if you are doing surgery, there won't be bleeding. I will do bloodless surgery, but it's not possible. There will be some bleeding, but you have to check them. Control of hemorrhage, I will discuss the methods last. Okay. Next, obliteration of dead space. After the removal of this tumor, suppose you have removed this tumor. Okay, this was in a lateral view. If you go for dorsoventral view or ventrodorsal view, there will be creation of a dead space after removal of tumor. Okay, this is abdomen. There will be dead space. Okay, you have to remove this dead space or obliterate this dead space, because in the dead space there will be accumulation of exudate or blood. Those are very good medium for growth of bacteria. So there will be sepsis. So you have to avoid sepsis. Also, you have to obliterate the dead space. So you can give continuous sutures, okay, to minimize the dead space. Okay, there will be some dead space left, but it should be minimum. Next, minimum suture material. While using suture material, don't use as much as you want for suture material, because suture material are foreign bodies, okay? So there will be more tissue reaction. So if there is, suppose one vicryl is needed for this, vicryl is polyglactin suture, I will deal that in biomaterial class. Okay, suppose one vicryl or polyglactin 910 is enough for this closure of this dead space. Okay, so use that much only. Don't go for another vicryl for two continuous layer sutures. Okay, that is not necessary, because there will be too much tissue reaction, even if there will be post-operative complications. Okay, so use minimum amount of suture material. Next, avoidance of suture tension. This is very important. Suppose you have given the subcutaneous suture. After subcutaneous suture, the incision will like with this. Okay, it will come closer. After that, you have to do skin closure. Suppose you are using horizontal mattress pattern. This will also be dealt in biomaterial class. Suppose you are using horizontal mattress suture. Okay. So while tightening the knot, you have to tight when the knot will touch the skin, that much is. Don't make too tight. What will happen if you will make too tight? The blood circulation to this area will be minimized, or sometimes they will be blocked, so that this area becomes necrosed and there may be suture dehiscence. Okay. Also, there is another thing. If you are doing too much of a tension here, okay, there is chance that this knot can be get buried inside, because after 1 or 2 days there, or even after 24 hours, there will be inflammation. When there will be inflammation, you know the signs of inflammation, there is a swelling. So when they will be swell up, this suture tension will become more tight. Okay, if you are doing tight, then it will be severely tight, which will reduce further the blood flow. So you have to give adequate tension, but not too much tension. This is avoidance of suture tension. Next is immolation. After you have done perfect surgery, okay, you have closed the wound. Okay, you have closed the incision site. Now immobilization. So what you do, what you can tell your patient, don't give overfeeding or too much of feed, so that there will be more suture tension, or avoid barking. Well, the animal barks excitedly. The wound edges, these are two edges, they move, okay, like they will glide, or there will be some movement. So movement restricts the healing. Okay, if these two opposed tissue will be still, that will be healed perfectly and in faster, rather than where there is continuous movement between the wounds. Okay, you can understand this better in fracture. Okay, when there will be bone immobilization, suppose this is a fracture segment, okay, you have to provide external cooperation bandage or internal immobilizer. Name itself suggests immobilization there will be there. Okay, that will, in that case there will be better healing. So this is immobilization. This is all about tenets of Halstead. You can understand by this tumor surgery operation. What you have done, these are nothing but tenets of Halstead. Next, the control of hemorrhage. This can come as a short note in your examination. Okay, first one is tourniquet. Okay, when you will apply, suppose you are doing any surgery of extremities. Suppose you are doing surgery of paw or surgery of tail. Those are extremities. There you can use tourniquet. Okay, suppose you are doing chordectomy. Okay, this is a tail. You are doing chordectomy. So you have to apply a tight rope or tourniquet around the base of the tail, which is known as which can call as tourniquet, to reduce the blood flow. Okay, or bleeding. That is known as tourniquet. Next is Esmar's bandage. Esmar's bandage is nothing but a tourniquet, but here what happens, you have to apply a bandage. Okay, suppose a 4-inch bandage, you have to apply 4-inch bandage in a tight fashion. This is nothing but, you see, in tourniquet the width is very less, the Esmar's bandage the width is more. These are nothing but same. Okay, next, thermocautery, using heat or cold for cauterization. For cold, you know, liquid nitrogen, LN2, liquid nitrogen can be used to coagulate. Okay, this acts as coagulation. Okay, there is, suppose there is a blood vessel where the bleeding is there, you can take a liquid nitrogen or dip a sponge in liquid nitrogen and you can coagulate this blood vessels. Okay, thermocauterization. Also, you can use heat. There are electrocautery machines also available, where you can give incisions and coagulation of blood vessels. Those are nothing but thermocauterization. Okay, those are very highly sophisticated instruments. Okay, next is crossing. Crossing is nothing but you apply a forceps. Okay, any forceps, mostly hemostatic forceps, you cross the vessel. Okay, wait for 2-3 minutes, then remove the vessel. Okay, this is nothing but crossing. There will be blood clot formation, just point nearer to the crossing point. Okay, there will be blood vessel, blood clot formation, and there will be blockage of blood loss. Next is forceps, mostly hemostatic forceps, which you know as artery forceps. You can apply the artery forceps to reduce the blood flow. Next is torsion. Torsion is nothing but rotating the blood vessel in its own axis. Okay, suppose you apply the clamp here, then you rotate this one. Okay, this is nothing but torsion. Ligation, you see, ligation is the best among all these methods. Ligation is the best method because it suits all type of blood vessels. Okay, you see, thermocautery, if the blood vessel is up to 2 to 3 mm diameter, then thermocautery holds good. But beyond 2 to 3 mm, you have to go for ligation. Okay, ligation is the best method. Next, digital pressure. Digital pressure is applied when there, suppose you have done a tumor surgery and you have ligated the major blood vessel. Still, there will be very small blood vessels will be oozing out. So, what you have to do, suppose there, this is an open cavity. Okay, there is small points from where there is some amount of bleeding. You take a gauze. Okay, you apply it here and apply digital pressure for 5 minutes or 3 minutes, 4 minutes, whatever. Okay, you apply the pressure and hold it like this. Oh, after 5 minutes, you will remove. You can see there will be less bleeding. Okay, this is digital pressure. And also another example of digital pressure is when you do the extirpation of eyeball. Okay, in case of small animal, in cats or small breed of dogs, where you can't find the optical vessels to ligate, so what you do, remove the eyeball, then apply the digital pressure. Okay, next is drugs. Many drugs are available for anti-hemorrhagic drugs, you can say. Suppose hemocoagulase. Okay, in brand name Boa Butterpage. Okay, hemocoagulase, tranexamic acid is there, etamsilate is there. Those are anti-hemorrhagic drugs you can give to control the bleeding. Okay, in reality, in intraoperative procedures, the control of hemorrhage is not a single technique. it is always use of combination technique. You see, in case of mammary tumor surgery, which I explained, you can use thermocautery. If it is not available, you can use crossing, applying hemostatic forceps, and ligation and distal pressure. Okay. All these methods are applied. So, in any surgery, single technique won't give you result. Instead, you have to use combination of technique. So, this is nothing but control of hemorrhage. You make your own note in your own language and write it down. Important thing is you have to write all the points or all the methods of control of hemorrhage. Okay. So, this is all about tenets of Halstead. Okay. This was a basic class about introduction to the surgery. Okay. After that, we'll go for principle of asepsis, sterile technique, preparation of patient. Like this, we'll cover all the topics of principles of surgery. So, thank you very much. Previous, the definition and type, those are objective type questions. Okay. No short note or long question will come from that part. Okay. So, thank you. And if you like this video, you can share to your friends of same college or different college, so that it can reach maximum veterinarians. Thank you very much for all your support and love. Now we are more than 500 subscribers. So thank you. Bye.